This podcast contains explicit content.
My hands are sweaty.
Why?
Knees weak. Mom.
I don't know, but they're sweaty and they're all. What did he say?
Hardly focused.
We're Hardly Focused. You can get us at hardlyfocused.com. You can find us on Facebook. We're on Facebook at facebook.com/hardlyfocusedpodcast. We're also on Twitter. You can find us at Focus Hardly. It is a special edition of the Acc and Jack Show because it's just Acc and Jack today. And real talk now. News came out this week that one of the living Boston Marathon bomber, whose name I think I can pronounce, Dzhokhar Tsarnaev.
I thought it was Dzhokhar, like Dzhokhar Tsarnaev.
I at least have some degree of respect for those whose names I try to pronounce and then feel a bit of regret when I get the names wrong. In this guy's case, fuck him. Yeah. Fuck him and fuck his name. If I'm mispronouncing it, who cares? That's how I've heard the on the news radio they pronounce it as Dzhokhar. Yeah. So
I don't know. That's fair.
I don't know if that was like a nickname that they just decided to go with because it was easier to pronounce. Who knows? But Dzhokhar Tsarnaev, according to Vox.com, actually according to every media outlet out there, according to Vox.com, Dzhokhar Tsarnaev was sentenced to death for his role in the 2013 Boston Marathon bombing. This happened in 2015. This past Friday, that death sentence was overturned when a federal appeals court ruled that the jury at Tsarnaev's initial trial was not properly screened for bias. Ack, what do you think about that? Screening and not properly screened for bias.
It's the kind of thing that I'm always amazed is ever able to be done, especially these days where there's such a prevalent social media and 24-hour news media. And for these massive, high-profile cases, finding someone in the Boston area who has no potential bias about the largest case, most infamous case in Boston in years, I just don't even know how they figure that out.
Right? Yeah. It's obviously nowhere... And I gotta be careful how I phrase this. It's nowhere near the scope of some other domestic terrorist acts in this country. I mean, 9/11 was 9/11. We had the Oklahoma City bombing. We had the Atlanta bombing in 96 during the Olympics. The Boston Marathon bombing, it's on that list of some of the worst acts of domestic terrorism in our nation. And it, especially for Boston people, yeah, it's going to be a very touchy and sensitive subject. And you would be hard-pressed to find anyone that wouldn't be gung-ho towards seeing this guy put down.
But even regardless of whether or not, you know, you're gung-ho about wanting him to get the death penalty specifically, I'm pretty sure you're supposed to like not take in any outside sources during the court case.
Right.
Like if you're on the jury, you aren't supposed to listen to the news or read any outside sources. You're supposed to fully only get all of your information from the court case. How the hell do you manage that these days?
Yeah. I mean, don't they like, especially if you're on like a federal jury, don't they just lock you in a hotel for pretty much the entire duration of the trial and they don't let you leave and talk to anyone besides the jurors?
That's probably what you'd have to do.
Yeah. Rid yourself of outside influence.
Right.
The Vox article here continues. It says, according to the Associated Press, Tsarnaev's legal team greeted the news with relief, reporting they called the court's ruling a, quote, straightforward and fair decision, while the Boston Globe reported anger from the families of his victims. That's understandable. Not just anger from the families of the victims, anger from pretty much anybody who lives in New England.
Mm-hmm. You know, I mean, I would definitely understand anger if they tried to, like, lessen his punishment or make him eligible for parole or anything like that. Personally, this is just me. I don't see that much moral difference between life imprisonment and the death penalty. I don't really have that passionate a pro or anti death penalty opinion. I'm not someone who's necessarily thirsting for blood. Like, if he's locked up behind bars forever, that's enough for me. I don't feel like I need him to be killed in order for some concept of justice to be served.
Yep. Quickly, we're streaming this segment on our Facebook page at facebook.com/HardlyFocusedPodcast. Our friend Chris Martell says, when the judge makes a critical error of law, we can expect this. The death penalty has to be not only morally applied, but legally as well. If we don't follow the laws, rules, and regulations of the governing statutes, then our justice system is flawed.
Mm-hmm. Well, yeah. When I was getting my paralegal degree, most of the professors were either current or former judges or current and former attorneys. And one of them was a former defense attorney who frequently had to defend drug dealers and, you know, bad people. I don't think he ever defended someone on the level of a domestic terrorist, but, you know, but people that we tend to think of as villains who belong behind bars. And he said, you know, people would often ask him and accuse him, sort of like, how can you defend these people? You know they're guilty. And he'd say, I'm not defending their guilt or innocence. I'm making sure they get the due process that every human being is entitled to.
Yeah, that's a really good point. Yeah. And
so, like, you can go into it knowing they're guilty and still believe earnestly that they deserve sincere representation in the eyes of the law.
And I think that's something that folks tend to forget. Mm-hmm. They don't think about that. Now, everyone who is upset about this, the death penalty being overturned, which, again, is something that they're going to revisit. He could very likely get it.
Yeah, he could very easily get the death penalty again, which is another thing that I think maybe people don't realize when they're so angry about this. This is literally just like an administrative blip more than a moral statement.
It's almost sort of playing into why they overturned it, because of bias. Just look at the, just gauge the reactions. Gauge the reactions of everyone who saw the post that I put up on our Hardly Focused Facebook page, mm-hmm. where I voiced my opinion, which is something I very rarely do on that page. But it was a sincere opinion of something I believe in. And I do want to get to that. But just falling back on what Chris in our chat said, the Vox article here concludes, the appeals court's 182-page ruling found that the judge overseeing the 2015 trial in which Tsarnaev was sentenced to death, George A. O'Toole Jr., did not take great enough care to ensure fairness during the jury selection. Again, that's going to be difficult, because if you're picking anybody from the New England area, they're all going to have the same opinion.
Right.
It's going to be very, very hard to find any sort of jury who does not look at this unanimously and all say, give him the death penalty. Now, here's what I think, and this is, I think, what you were alluding to earlier, Ack. The death penalty, in my opinion, is an easy way out. It's almost like a cheat code to finish the game. The death penalty just, it ends, yes, it gives the guy justice, it serves justice, and people will feel better if he dies. I'm a sadist. I'm just, this is just me. But I've done a lot of research into where Tsarnaev is right now. Tsarnaev, if you didn't know, right now has been spending the last several years at ADX Florence in Colorado. ADX Florence is a supermax prison. It's the only federal supermax prison in the Union. Supermax, it's a place you don't want to be. If you ever have to go to prison, it's a place you don't want to be. It is, you know, the beginning of, I think it was Get Smart with the many doors that are opening. That is Supermax. It's just, there's no way to get it. It is impenetrable and you cannot escape. And in Florence, Colorado, ADX Florence, this is where they house all of the worst of the worst of the worst. Every domestic terrorist, every spy, any horrible person you can think of. What got me interested in this place was a spy. He was a former CIA agent, or FBI agent, Robert Hansen, known for one of the worst intelligence leaks in history. The guy worked for the FBI and was using his power at the FBI to give information to the Soviets in the middle of the Cold War, giving government secrets to the Soviets. And in 2001, he got caught doing what was supposed to be his last dead drop. He said, this is the last one I'm doing. I'm never doing it anymore. And he got busted because people were monitoring.
I was 3 days away from spy retirement.
There's a really good movie, too, starring Chris Cooper and Ryan Phillippe. I'm blanking on a name of it right now, but it is about that, you know, Hansen's final days as an FBI agent, because he was assigned an assistant who is actually profiling him and was chronicling all the stuff so the FBI could catch him. I bring all this up because the man is spending the rest of his life in ADX Florence. He was given like something like 11 life sentences. There's no way that this dude will ever get out.
But I do find that an inherently funny idea. Like, I understand the logic behind it, but to hear someone get multiple consecutive life sentences is one of those like little oopsies of our law. we forgot that literally can't happen.
Well, if one gets, you know, if one gets overturned, you still have 10 more you need to go through.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah. So he's spending the rest of his life there, and in a supermax prison cell, it is literally the size of a bathroom. You get a window that's like maybe 6 inches, if that, maybe 3 inches in length, so you could barely see the outside. You've got you got a toilet and a shower and a bed. If you're on good behavior, you get a television. Actor Woody Harrelson, his father, lived out the rest of his days in a ADX Florence prison cell because he either killed a judge or tried to have a judge killed. And he actually wrote a very interesting letter that gave a lot of insight into what it was like to be in one of those cells. And he spoke highly. He was like, he must have had something going wrong up here because he was speaking highly of it. He was saying that, like, they give us a TV for good and you get like channels and you can listen to the radio. Like, they do things to try to keep you sane. But who the hell is going to be sane when you're stuck in a prison cell that is the size of a bathroom that is also literally a bathroom? And, you're let out one hour a day for recreation. ADX Florence has been called, quote, a clean version of hell. In my opinion, that is worse than the death penalty. And that is what Tsarnaev should have. Because if you think about it, people are like, oh, he's going to spend the rest of his life in jail. I'm a taxpayer and I got to pay for this, blah, blah, blah. The man is going, his brain is going to go to mush. Because he is going to be stuck in a tiny jail cell. He's barely going to be able to go anywhere. If he does anything that pisses off any of the guards, they're going to beat him to within an inch of his life. They don't fuck around there. And plus, he's also going to have to share a cell, or not a cell, but like he's going to share space with not Timothy McVeigh, he's dead, but the other guy who was responsible for the Oklahoma City bombings, the shoe bomber, Zacharias Moussaoui is there, one of the guys who orchestrated the World Trade Center bombing in 93, the Atlanta guy is there too, the Atlanta bombing guy. There's a lot of people there, a lot of domestic terrorists that are there, and there have been accounts that all these people are just not, they're not quite right mentally. And there's even some cases and interviews done with people who have spent time at ADX Florence who got out, didn't have life sentences, who got out, and they're like, I'd rather die. I would rather not be alive than have to spend another day in a supermax prison.
Yeah, I believe that.
So,
I mean, I come to sort of the same conclusion, not necessarily out of sadism, but I believe the point of prison shouldn't be for punishment. It should be for either rehabilitation or the safety of the rest of society. And I think there are people whose continued coexistence in society is going to result in danger to other people, that they simply cannot be functioning members of society. I think it's rare, but I think those people do exist. And that's why I said, you know, I'm not fiercely pro or anti death penalty. I think it's not about whether we're killing them for justice or locking them up so they suffer. It's about making sure they can't continue to hurt other people in society.
Yeah.
Just so long as they are removed from their ability to do that, I think that the justice system has done its job.
Yeah, and that's why those guys, exactly why those guys are there.
Yeah.
They
will. These are people who will not be integrating back into polite society.
Yeah, and there's been stories too I've read where they've tried to, they have like, you know, some semblance of a prison yard, and they've actually tried to, you know, put, during rec times, put two people in the same area together, and it just never goes well.
Yeah.
So,
wow.
I've done an odd amount of research
into it's fascinating. It I've always enjoyed reading about serial killers and cult leaders and just the worst people you can think of. It's fascinating to think about, like, what goes through their heads, what we do to them to get them out of society. Like, it's just, it's morbid, but it's incredibly interesting.
I'll tell you this too. I don't know if anything has changed recently, but ADX Florence, one of the only places, if not the only place in the United States, that has not reported a single case of COVID-19. How could you?
Yeah. That's a really good point.
Yeah. It is nay impossible to come down with it there. The reason why ADX Florence exists, a man named Thomas Silverstein, who passed away, actually, I think either this year or late 2019, he killed two prison guards in the 80s and was given his own, like, wing of a federal penitentiary because they determined him to be such a threat. And wow. they called it the Silverstein Suite. And that whole thing led to ADX Florence being constructed because they were like, hey, we need to do something about the worst of the worst of the worst. And
yeah,
if you ever look up Silverstein, he actually he became an artist because he was stuck in a prison cell and he couldn't do anything. So he actually became like a very talented and skilled artist and would just draw his surroundings. And it was,
I call this one my cell. I call this one my cell.
But it was insight, because how else are you going to see what one of these things look like? There are like images out there. If you do any Google search, you can find images, pictures that have been taken when the very few times they've ever let press do tours of the prison. But otherwise, there's just renderings largely based on what Silverstein was drawing and showing to people. So, very, very detailed drawings of his toilet. What else is he going to draw?
Yeah, exactly.
So, also one of the few times I think that people in this country are going to agree with Donald Trump, pushing for Tsarnaev to get the death penalty.
Well, and again, I think Trump kind of represents the ugliest impulses of Americans in most, if not all, ways. And I think this is one of them. I don't think Trump is necessarily capable of caring about the concept of justice or even understanding it. I think he's just bloodthirsty.
Oh yeah.
And I think a lot of people are. I think it's a massive thing in America where we kind of, it's like, look at all the recent conspiracy theories about pedophile rings, right? The whole QAnon thing and how all Hollywood is filled with pedophiles and all that. It's this desire to have villains that are so unambiguously evil that it's okay for us to want to murder them. And it's this bloodthirst, but this understanding, well, I can't just go kill random people, so I have to invent these supervillains, these unbelievable, irredeemable people in the shadows. So when I fantasize about murdering them, I'm the good guy, but I still get to commit murder.
Yeah.
And I think that's kind of something Trump buys into a lot. Like, you know, when he tells these stories about, like, going to kill Islamic terrorists with bullets dipped in pig's blood and stuff like that, it's just cruelty. It's just like, these are people that no one's going to defend. No one's going to say, oh, they're good people. But I would say, is it really necessary for us to be this jazzed about killing them? Like, that's still kind of weird to get, like, super pumped up about, like, fuck yeah, kill them, kill those motherfuckers. I just don't share that desire for bloodlust, even for people who deserve it.
This might be an uneducated comment from me or insight, but now most of our prior presidents, those guys have like law degrees, right? Or some form of
mostly,
it. Mostly,
like, yeah.
They have some understanding of the
generals in the army or
yeah. They have some understanding of the judicial system. They can look mm-hmm. at this logically and look at it from both sides. Not that of a businessman who most of his businesses have all gone bankrupt.
Right.
So
yeah, I think Trump's appeal in to the degree that he still has any, is just giving voice to these ugly impulses that, you know, for a long time it was considered impolite to say. But a lot of people were kind of like, come on, you know that these people deserve to get fucking killed. Take them out back and put a bullet in their head. Well, who needs lethal injection? Or like these kind of edgy, like, locker room talk, you know, opinions.
Yeah. And it's going to get the supporters, too.
Oh, yeah. It riles people up.
Yeah. Last night, I saw a commercial on, I think it was on Comedy Central, for the Trumpy Bear. Have you seen that? Oh.
No.
Oh, dear.
Is it ironic or unironic?
It's, oh, man, I don't know how to do a screen share on this. Apparently, this thing came out right around the time that Trump got elected.
Okay.
So let me see if I can do... Give me 1 second here. Can you see my can you see my Trumpy the YouTube screen here?
Yes.
Okay, here we go. Trumpy Bear. This is real.
The wind whispered through the forest. A storm is coming. You cannot defeat the storm. From the trees rose a resounding voice. I fear nothing. I come when the trumpet sounds. I am the storm, the great American grizzly. Introducing the original Trumpy Bear, the fearless, super plush American grizzly. Trumpy Bear was born June 14th, Flag Day. Just find the secret zipper and pull out the flag blanket. Then wrap yourself in the red, white, and blue for comfort and warmth. Show your patriotism and proudly display Trumpy on Flag Day and on any American holiday. Trumpy can even honor your own family heroes.
God bless America and God bless Trumpy Bear.
Trumpy Bear sits proudly at the front of the motorcycle for all the world to see and loves to cruise with his brother.
I'm a former Marine and I'm proud to have Trumpy Bear ride by my side. Once a Marine, always a Marine.
Everyone knows Trumpy Bear loves to go to the golf course.
When I ride with Trumpy Bear, he makes my golf game great again. Thank you, Trumpy Bear.
Simply style his trademark hair and place him in his favorite chair. Even the toughest guys will love Trumpy Bear.
When America is great, business is great. When business is great, I am great. I love you, Trumpy Bear.
I am an Army veteran. I am proud to own the Trumpy Bear, and I will always be proud to be an American.
Order the Super Plus Trumpy Bear for only two payments of $19.95 and receive a special certificate of authenticity. Don't miss out on owning a piece of American history. Order now for only two payments of $19.95. Trumpy, the most fearless bear anywhere. Order now.
That is real.
Is it over?
That is a real thing. Hold on. What is this old guy's name? Fuck you. Hold on.
I am an Army.
An Army veteran whose name is Warholic.
Oh my God. Like, that was just too on the nose. If that were a Stephen Colbert bit, he wouldn't have to do anything different for it to be a parody.
I saw it on Comedy Central, and I really thought it was, like, a fake thing, and it's real. It's absolutely
oh my God.
Real. Oh, dear.
I don't want to live on this planet anymore. That's the thing, though, about Trump's support. It strongly correlates with being a sucker. If you've ever looked at any of Trump's tweets and then looked down in the comments, tons of them right underneath are people unaffiliated with the Trump campaign just shilling Trump-branded gear, like Trump train t-shirts and like just all kinds of shoddily made, poorly constructed clothing and household objects with Trump's name on them.
Yeah.
Or Make America Great Again on them. And that is like an amazing grift. Like if you do something like that and target it at Trump supporters, they're going to fucking buy it because they don't know any better.
Thinking is not their strong suit.
I'm a very intelligent person.
Are you?
Yeah.
Nobody's done a job like I've done.
Really? Have you? Have they?
I mean,
I am the chosen one.
Yeah.
I'm trying to think of another president who has had 100,000 people die of a plague.
Yeah. No plague was better under any other president until me. At least Nixon, you know, did the... At least Nixon kept his whatever dignity he had by resigning.
Hmm. Yeah.
So
I could say I'm the most bullied person on the world.
On the world. I want to bully her for that.
But that goes against her her Be Best.
Her
Be Best campaign. No more bullying.
Trump Tower, this is Donald. Well, we can deep fry the hell out of chicken, I can tell you that.
You watch Community, right?
No, I haven't.
Really?
It's a show that I am interested in watching, mostly because Stephanie and I have gotten really into The Masked Singer.
Yeah.
And Ken Jeong is a co-host on that, and he's really funny on that show. And I know he's in Community, so.
Yeah, he's just as good on Community. I watched up until... I think I'm on season 4 right now, and I haven't watched it because season 4 is the season where Dan Harmon left.
Mm-hmm.
And you can just see the quality and the writing. There's something about the first 3 seasons of that show, especially season 2, that's just so good. And he is such a vital component to it. And it's missing.
It's one of those things I remember hearing, and again, as someone who hasn't watched it personally, this is just what I've absorbed through pop culture osmosis. Is it was an extremely beloved cult hit show. It got canceled. The fans madly petitioned for it to get picked up again. It was, and then everyone hated it after it got renewed again. Like, it just wasn't the same. And I feel like that happens so often. And yet every time a show is canceled, we freak out and demand it be brought back, even though it's always worse.
Yeah.
And would have been better if we just let it be a few really good seasons than bring it back in like just as a half-hearted mediocre show.
Or you pull a Family Guy and bring it back and it's okay for the first couple seasons that it's been revived, and then here we are in 2020 still getting Family Guy.
Yeah, I mean, I think they looked at The Simpsons and thought, well, they seem to be doing good, so let's with that.
But they aren't. They haven't been for a very long time. Why? Stop giving these people money.
Earlier about having difficulty like gauging time between events, I did see one graph once of, it was after like 20 seasons of The Simpsons, this is probably a few years ago now too. But it had like a bunch of major milestones of like the lowest rated episode of all time.
Mm-hmm.
It was like, at this point, there have been 6 episodes with the titles being puns of Mona Lisa.
Yeah.
And then at one point, it had the exact indicator, and it was like around season 15. And it was, at this point, there have been more bad episodes than good ones.
Which is very unfortunate.
Seeing that was the one that made me go, oh, that sucks.
not to mention, too, that while the main voice cast, and God, I'm just going to start knocking on wood because I have a tendency of saying things and then having those celebrities pass on immediately afterwards. The main voice cast, they're all up there in age, but they're all still around. But Krabappel, passed away a long time ago. We just lost the voice of Martin and several other characters, and Minnie Mouse too. And they recast those characters, and it just doesn't sound right. Like, what's going to happen if, like, Harry Shearer retires or passes? What are you going to do? He already tried to quit once, and there was a big panic over it.
Yeah, I remember that.
So, yeah. It's also kind of jarring to think that, like, Hank Azaria is now the same age or in the same age bracket as Harry Shearer when The Simpsons first started.
Yeah, I know.
And he's been around since the beginning, too. So that's got to say something, though, when you spent literally your entire adult life playing Mo.
I know. That is crazy.
Yeah. All right. Coming up, we're going to talk about Nintendo and what is called the Giga Leak.
And should Bowser get the death penalty? Weigh in the comments.
I don't know why that's so funny, but it is. All right, we will return.
Hardly Focused.
What was that name of that Neon Genesis?
I can never fucking pronounce it right.
This podcast is Hardly Focused.
Evangeline and Jolie.
Hear more at HardlyFocused.com.
Man, I fucking love the franchise, and I can't even fucking pronounce the name right.